السلام عليك على إخواني وإخواتي في جامعة البصرة.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا دكتور.
وشلون حالتكم؟ زين إن شاء الله.
الحمد لله بخير وعافية. الله يخليك.
الحمد لله.
عليكم السلام دكتور.
السلام عليكم.
ورحمة
السلام عليكم. السلام عليكم.
أهلا وسهلا.
To all of you. I am ready to start whenever you ask me. So it's okay from my side.
Okay, you can start.
Okay. I understand a little bit of Arabic, شوية عربيك. As مسقط الرأس نجف. I was born in Najaf, so I was spent my first 5 years of life in Najaf. Then I migrated to Iran. Unfortunately, my Arabic is not much. I hope that sometime I can improve my Arabic so that we can have a conversation in Arabic, inshallah.
Inshallah. You can speak Arabic, although it knows, it is not perfect, but our student in master degree, not all them speak English perfect. You
good,
can speak Arabic, okay. Arabic or Arabic. English, as you like.
Okay, good. Yes, no. I speak in English. I cannot speak in Arabic for a long time. Yeah. But I understand Arabic. Sometimes I listen actually to my mom was born in Iraq as well, so she knew Arabic, and my mother-in-law as well as my father-in-law, all of them have been in Iraq for a long time.
Okay.
So shall we start?
إن شاء الله. يعني هو الدكتور يقول إنه أنا يعني عربيتي شوي ضعيفة، الإنجليزية عندي أحسن.
Not أحسن but better than my Arabic.
أوكي. إذا شو اسمه ترجمي لبعض الطلبة هذه كذا أو ترجمي الكلام من يجوز هناك تلكؤ في اللغة.
أي والله إن شاء الله يعني.
إن شاء الله. شكرا جزيلا.
أوكي. Shall we start?
Yes.
Okay.
Why doctor don't keep your language Arabic?
Pardon?
Why doctor you don't keep your language?
Actually, I was born in a community of Iranian in Iraq. So we were a small community, and I left Iraq before school age. If I was there for a school age, my Arabic would have been much better. But because I was inside the family, I couldn't learn Arabic. When I migrated to Iran, I had on some occasions I was with Iranian migrated from Iraq, so they talk Arabic. I learn a little bit of Arabic, not much.
That very gentle for you. Keep your language. That very
Inshallah.
Gentle.
Inshallah. Yeah, sure. Actually, my son is very keen to improve his Arabic. He has gone to many classes Arabic, and his Arabic is good. He's not here at the moment. He could have helped me to talk in Arabic. Okay. If it's okay, I can start so that we don't lose the time. Yeah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله أيها الإخوة والأخوات الأعزاء العراقيين من جامعة البصرة. It's a pleasure for me to present a talk to you. Thank you all for participating in this event. I also would like to thank the organizers of this event, the Ferdowsi University of Mashhad and the University of Basra. My special thanks to Dr. Anwar. The topic of my talk is the trajectory of the development of Shi'ite political thought. What I'm trying to say in this paper is that Shi'ite political thought has gone through many changes and diversifications throughout history. We cannot talk about the Shi'ite political thought, as there are many different types of Shi'ite political thought. Shi'ite political thought has not been fixed and constant. It has changed and adapted itself to different environments in different historical periods and different societies with diverse social, cultural, and political features. So my point is that there is not only one version of Shi'ite political thought, there are many, and there has been many accounts of Shi'ite political thought throughout the history. In this paper, the development of Shi'ite political thought is discussed. So my main question is what changes have occurred in Shi'ite political thought throughout history and why? What I mean by political thought is firstly the Shi'ite account of political legitimacy. What kind of government is legitimate and how legitimacy is achieved? This is the main, the first point. The second point is how to deal with illegitimate government. In Shia terminology, it is Hukumat al-Ja'ir, Hukam al-Ja'ir. How to deal with Hukam al-Ja'ir. So altogether, what I mean by political thought is political legitimacy, the way to deal with illegitimate government, and altogether the link between religion and politics. Of course, we know that there is an interaction between the doctrine, the text, Nas, Nusus, and the social and political realities which exist in every society out there. My point is that there has been always an interaction between them. Shi'ite political thought formed and changed in this dialectic, in this dialogue between reality and the doctrine, between the society and Nas. To begin with, we should understand that Shi'ite political thought has been formed within the wider context of Islamic political thought. So the general features of Islamic political thought altogether, I mean Sunni, even Khawarij account of political thought, various Shi'at sects, Ismailis and others altogether, they have some general features for which we can call all of them Islamic. So Shi'at political thought as well is part of this wider tradition of Islamic political thought. It has some similarities with other sects, other ta'ifa account of political thought. Nevertheless, it has its own identity. The distinctive feature of Shia theology is the concept of imamah. according to the concept of Imama, the ultimate religious and political authority is vested in divinely appointed Imam, Al-A'immatil Ma'sumin. So what makes Shia distinct from other tawa'if, from other sects, is this concept of Imama. Nevertheless, it shares other aspects with other sects within the Islamic culture. So there are some similarities, some differences. Differences are mainly on the concept of Imama, as all of us, we know, of course. So my argument is that the Shia political thought has gone through five different phases. In this slide, you see a kind of two axes. The horizontal axis is the time. As you will see, it is five stages, five period of times. There is a mistake in this slide. I should apologize for that. In this slide, we have four stage in the horizontal axis, but it should be five. Actually, I improved it. I changed it a little bit, yeah, but I couldn't. I forget to change this axis. So anyway.
Excuse me, doctor.
Yeah.
Can I translate the little bit of what I understand to the other student? And
in Arabic?
Yes, please. Is that okay?
Right. Yeah, okay. Right. Up to you.
العفو الأساتذة يعني حسب اللي أنا افتهمت يعني من الكلام اللي تفضل به الدكتور إنه الموضوع مات المحاضرة يتناول التوجه السياسي للشيعة واللي هم يعتبرون يعني أحد التوجهات أو الاتجاهات الدينية اللي موجودة في المجتمعات الإسلامية واجتمعوا بصفات مشتركة مع باقي التوجهات يعني مثل السنة أو الإسماعيلية أو غيرهم فالكل مروا بنفس التغيرات لكن التوجه الشيعي أو المذهب الشيعي كان له مفهومه الخاص اللي هو يتعلق بالإمامة وعموما الدكتور راح يتناول الموضوع من خلال طرح التغيرات اللي مر بها المسار الشيعي واللي كان خلال خمس مراحل الباوربوينت هذا السلايد اللي يعرض جاي يعرض المراحل الزمنية اللي يعني صار بها التغير الشيعي هو مذكورة طبعا بالسلايد أربعة بس هي في حقيقتها مثل ما تفضل الدكتور خمسة هاي شكرا جزيلا دكتور
Okay. Actually, the horizontal axis is about the time. We have four stages, four phases. The first phase is the Imam's era, Asrul A'imma. The second stage is the occultation to the beginning of the Safavid Empire. عصر الغيبة until صفوية the formation of the Safavid Empire in Iran and the third stage is the Safavid Empire until the Iranian constitutional revolution of 1905 and so, actually this is a little bit we can say for example until the constitutional revolution of 1905 or even similar to Iraqi Surat al-Ashrain it's similar there are some we will see that actually in this paper I concentrate mainly on Iranian fuqaha Fuqahol Iranian. Nevertheless, Fuqahol Iranian has been in close connection with the Arab Fuqaha So it is not very easy to distinguish between Arab fuqaha and Iranian fuqaha. Nevertheless, my concentration is mainly on Iranian side. Sometimes here and there, I refer to Arab fuqaha as well, which of course have a significant role, probably the most significant role in the formation of Shia political thought. So this is the third stage. The fourth stage is the from the constitutional, the Iranian constitutional revolution of 1905 until the Islamic revolution of 1979. And the fifth stage is after the Islamic revolution, the contemporary era in which we live now. This is the horizontal axis, the vertical axis is actually a kind of overlap between politics and religion. My point from this diagram is that the Shiite political thought has changed and experienced a U-turn, so that it started in the era of A'imma, Asrul A'imma, with the total unity of politics and religion. Then, in the era of Ghaiba, occultation, it moved toward a kind of quietism, or what I call political minimalism. In that area, as we will see, in that period, the overlap between politics and religion has gone to its minimum. In the first stage, it is the maximum overlap. In this stage, it is a minimum overlap. Then we will see in the third stage, after the formation of the Safavid Empire, again, there is a kind of return to politics. In the Iranian Constitutional Revolution, we will see a participation of ulama, fuqaha, to politics. So it's a kind of active politics or political activism, as I mentioned here. And in the Islamic Revolution of Iran, with the leader under the leadership of Imam Khomeini, we have a kind of political proactivism. So as we will see in this diagram, my point is that there has been a U-turn in Shiite account of politics, by which I mean that the diversification and development and a lot of change in Shiite account of politics. So my first point was that there is no one account of Shiite political thought. There are several of them, many of them, changing throughout the history. So I go to the first stage. I will try in the rest of my lecture, I will try to explain these five stages, beginning with the first one, the Imam's era, or the Asrul A'im. I call this period the formative period. In this period, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lived. It has two different stages in his prophetic mission. First, the era of Mecca, and the second, the era of Medina. We know that there is a lot difference between these two eras. In Mecca, Prophet's teaching was mainly doctrinal. It was about اعتقادات والعبادات. It has a very marginal political side, Prophet's message in Mecca was against the cruelty of the Mala'a, the Ashraf al-Quraysh, but not more than that. When Prophet migrated to Medina, a different phase started, of course, in which the political extent of message was extended. So when Prophet came to Medina, he came as a referee to judge between differences of Aus and Khazraj. Aus and Khazraj, Al-Ansar, invited Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to judge between them and their differences. Probably 1 or 2 years after his migration to Medina, we have this Sahifatul Medina. In Sahifatul Medina, which is sometimes called the first constitution of Islam, as we know, the rule in Medina, the management of the city-state of Medina was decided how to defend the city, how different tribes, Aus, Khazraj, Yahud, can defend the city of Medina against the outside forces, and what they should do when there is differences, disputes among themselves. Prophet Muhammad was appointed as a judge, as a referee. Then we have in Medina, we have this Qazawat. After some years, Prophet's political role was increased. So in these 10 years of Prophet Muhammad in Medina, his political role increased until the end. When Prophet Muhammad died in year 11 of Ba'tha, of Hijrah, we can say he was a kind of fully fledged politician, fully fledged ruler of the Medina, not only the Medina, by then, of course, whole of the Jaziratul Arab was under his control. So he was at the end a kind of prophet as well as ruler, as well as a prophet, as well as a politician. So in this formative era, we have Prophet Muhammad's era. After him, Khulafa al-Rashidin. Of course, as we know, from Shia points of view, in this era of Khulafa al-Rashidin, Imam Ali's Khilafat al-Imam, the legitimate leadership. After him, Imam Hassan's Khilafah, which was very short, for about six months. After that came Umayyad's empire, and then Abbasid empire. During these two empires, Shi'at imams were not in a political position. What we have is only Imam Hussein's uprising in year 40, Qiyam al-Ashura. Then the other imams, the fourth imam, fifth imam, and sixth imam were not involved in explicit politics. As we know that Al-Imam al-Sadiq was invited to rule after the collapse of Banu Umayya, but he didn't accept. He didn't accept to rule. After Imam al-Sadiq, Imam Musa Kazim was imprisoned. I'm trying to say that how involved were Shi'at Imams after Imam Hussein. The only other political act on behalf of Al-A'immat al-Ma'sumin was when Imam Rida was appointed as Ma'mun's Wali Ahd, Ma'mun's heir apparent, his Wali Ahd. And after that, we don't have any involvement of Shi'at Imams into politics. So this was the first era, the formative period. This is the first stage. In this stage, the dominant political discourse, as I called it, is the unity of politics and religion. The discourse, the Shi'at political thought here is that based on the complete overlap between politics and religion. The main point in this discourse is the exclusive right of infallible imams to rule, which means that the exclusive حق الانحصارية الأئمة المعصومين to حكومة للحكومة. My Arabic is not good, but I'm trying sometime to say in Arabic as well as far as I can. So the main point is that exclusive right of أئمة المعصومين on the basis of this right to rule. There is an obligation to claim this right. Al-A'imma themselves, as well as the Shi'at community, have the right, have the duty, have the obligation to establish the rule of A'immat al-Ma'asumin. This can be done through reasoning, persuasion, dialogue, or even uprising, like what Imam Hussein done. But as we will see, most of the time, the attempt by Imams, for example, during Imam Ali, or Imam Hassan, or the others, was to claim the right to rule through reasoning. The only exception is Imam Hussein. When he was invited by the people of Kufa, after the Muawiyah's death, to come to Kufa and start an uprising. So this was a kind of exception, probably. Mainly, the right of A'imma to rule was claimed through persuasion and reasoning. So this is the main point in the first stage. But even in the first stage, we have a second layer of thought. This was the first layer of political thought. We have a second layer of political thought as well. What I have called here the emerging patterns of practice. So while the main point was the rule of A'immat al-Ma'sumin, the right of A'immat al-Ma'sumin to rule, there was a kind of other patterns among the Shi'at community, which was step by step emerging. And this was mainly based on avoiding politics. So Al-A'immat al-Shi'a, several of them tried to achieve power, political power, but when they were successful, they did it. When they were not successful, they avoided politics. As I mentioned, in fourth Imam, Imam Zainul Abidin, Imam Muhammad al-Baghir, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, Imam Musa al-Kazim, and mainly the rest of them, avoiding politics, withdrawing from politics. Nevertheless, a limited extent of cooperation was allowed. So even the AMA, when they avoided politics, withdraw from politics, they had some kind of cooperation with governments, with Hukam al-Jair, only to the extent that it was necessary, not more than that. Is that all right so far? Shall I continue? So this was my account of the first phase, the first period. Now we turn to the second period. The era of occultation, or the Asr al-Qaybah. In Shia terminology, as we know, there are two eras of Ghaybah, Ghaybatul Sughra and Ghaybatul Kubra. Ghaybatul Sughra, I think, is 260, and Ghaybatul Kubra is 329 Hijri. So this is the second from the Ghaiba, doesn't matter Ghaiba al-Kubra or Ghaiba al-Sughra, until the formation of the Safavid Empire. In this era, we have the Buwayhid dynasty, Al-Buwayh rule from 334 until 447 Hijri. As we know, the Al-Buya were Shi'at. There were, at the beginning, Zaydi Shi'at. After a while, they converted to 12 Shi'as, to Isna'a Sharia. Under their rule, the Shi'a were allowed to pronounce their belief, express their belief. They were allowed to perform their ritual, their manasik. They were allowed to build their own places for worship. Haram bu'a lil'a'imma, they were able to build. So it was a kind of good era for the Shi'at. They had some kind of relative freedom. They were allowed to do their own belief. For example, we have a big community of the Shi'at in Baghdad. Shi'at community in Iran, in different parts of the Islamic world, were allowed to do their own belief. At the same time, there are Hamdaniya rule in Syria, in Sham, they were Shi'at as well. So immediately after the Qaybat al-Kubra, there was a favorable environment for Shi'at to flourish, and they flourished. The Fiqh al-Shi'a was flourished under the rule of Al-Buya. For example, Sheikh al-Mufid, Sayyid al-Murtadha, Sayyid al-Radhi, they're working under Al-Buya rule, and the Shi'at fiqh was flourished. Usul al-fiqh al-Shi'iyya was written under in this era. After Al-Buya, there was Saljuqiyya, Salajqa. But as we know, Saljuqiyya were zeal Sunnis. They were mutasib to Sunniya. So they didn't tolerate the Shia and i'tiqadat al-Shi'iyya. Under their rule, the Shia withdrew from politics. They couldn't do anything. For example, ulama were expelled from Baghdad. They were stationed in Hilla and Najaf in Iraq. So this under the Saljuq, the environment was not very favorable for the Shi'at. After the Seljuk, we have the Mongols period, Mughals. Mughals were, of course, more favorable to Shia because at the beginning, for them, they didn't make any difference between Shia and Sunni. When they demolished the Abbasi Khalifa, the pillar, Abbasid Khalifa was the pillar of Sunni authority. So when this pillar was demolished, was destroyed, there was more freedom for other sects, non-Sunni sects, including the Shia. Even when the Mughal emperors were converted to Islam, the first one, I forget his name, was converted to Sunni. The second one was converted to Shi'ism, Uljaito, or called Sultan Muhammad Khuda Bande, means the servant of God. He was converted to Shia. After Uljaito, the rest of Mughal emperors were Sunni, but altogether, this area, this era under the Mughals were more tolerant to Shia. So the situation was become more favorable under the Mughal. So this was the historical events in the second stage. Now we go to the discourse in this stage, political Shi'at political thought in the second stage. So the first factors in Shi'at political thought in the second stage is again the exclusive right of the infallible imams to rule. As you will see, this element, this point, is repeated in all five stages. Why? Because this is the identity of the Shia. Shia is constituted on the basis of the exclusive right of A'immat al-Ma'sumin. So this is, you will see, this is repeated in all five stages. This point is not changed. Has not changed, but the other points have changed, as we will see. So the first point is the exclusive right of infallible imam. The second point is quietism. Quietism means silence about politics, being quiet about politics. There is no claim on politics. Why? Because of the concept of qaybah. Qaybah means imams are not available anymore. Imams are there in the society, but they are not accessible. You cannot access to them. So the point is, the point from political perspective means that A'imma cannot rule because they are not accessible. They are in ghaibah. Therefore, it leads to the second point, quietism. It means that any attempt to form a government is prohibited, is haram. You cannot try to establish any government because Imam is not available. And anybody else other than Imams cannot be a legitimate ruler. Whoever rules, with the exception of 12 Imams, is a Hakimul Ja'ir. Therefore, the very possibility of legitimate rulership is out of question in this era. This means that a kind of minimalism that I mentioned, a kind of withdrawal from politics. So the overlap between politics and religion come to its minimum extent. Nevertheless, there has been a limited cooperation with unjust rulers. This is because in our social life, we had to we have to relate with the government. Even if we withdraw from the government, from the politics, the ruler, the political ruler, do not leave us alone. They want our taxes. They sent us to the front for jihad, for war. They impose on us their law. So it is not possible to leave politics altogether. Never. Therefore, a kind of limited cooperation with Hukam al-Jair was accepted only to the extent necessary, only في الحد الاضطرار. So the cooperation, تعامل مع الحكام الجائر is to the extent necessary, حد الضرورة. سيد مرتضى, سيد الشريف, سيد المرتضى has a short book called as if I not forget the name in Arabic, رسالة مع التعامل, الرسالة في التعامل مع السلطان. The title I think is the same. I forget the complete name. In that it says that the Shi'at are allowed to cooperate with the ruler, but to the حد الاضطرار. This is because Shi'at fuqaha acknowledge the need for government. Every society need government in order to have its order, nazm and zabat, in order to flourish, to rule over disputes, to judge over disputes, we need a government. So fuqaha al-Shi'i, like Sheikh al-Mufid, Sayyid al-Murtaza, acknowledge that every society needs government, including Muslim society. They also accepted that in the time of Ghaybah, in the Asr al-Ghaybah, there are unjust rulers. They accepted the fact that the rulers of their time, as Abbasid Khulafa al-Abbasiyin or Salatin al-Saljuqi or Salatin al-Buwayhi, they were there. They were as a fact. So the cooperation was allowed, but with one condition: not pronounce the legitimacy of the ruler. You can cooperate with them, but you shouldn't explicitly acknowledge that they are legitimate. So the main point is in this era is quietism and limited cooperation with Hukam al-Jair. Nevertheless, in this period as well, there is a second layer of thought. Here again, there are emerging patterns of politics, emerging patterns of practice. The first point is that among the Shia, it emerged that they accept a kind of duality, a kind of divide between the religion and politics. They accept that there are two realms, there are two spheres, sphere of politics, sphere of religion. So a type of secularism. It is not similar to Western secularism as we know it now, but it is a type of secularism. There are spheres of politics, rulers, hukam, decide about public sphere, about order, about nazm, about security, amniya, internal security, external security. This is the sphere of politics, and then there is a sphere of religion. A sphere of politics is ruled by rulers, government, spheres of religion is ruled by fuqaha. For example, qaza, judging, fatwa, ibadat, al-ahkam, hudud al-shar'iyya, they were under the rule of fuqaha. And as I mentioned, issues of politics under the rule of a government. The second point about emerging patterns is that there should be a distinction between different types of unjust ruler. Before Al-Buya, for the Shia, there was only two kind of imam, Imam al-Adil wa Imam al-Ja'ir. Imam al-Adil means al-A'immat al-Ma'sumin. There are only 12 of them, not more, only 12. And the rest of Hukam are Ja'ir, unjust, Qasib. Whether they are Shi'at or not, it doesn't matter whether they are Shi'at al-Buya or Sunni, Salajaga. They are all Hukam al-Ja'ir. But after a while, the Shia understood that they should make a distinction between Al al-Buya wa Saljuqi, between Shi'at ruler and non-Shi'at ruler. It is not black and white. There are different types of unjust ruler. Hukam al-Ja'ir can be divided into three categories. This was the second point that they developed. The fuqaha was developed in this era. There are ja'irul kafir, like Mughals, before they converted to Islam. Then there were ja'irul mukhalif, like hukam al-sunnah, salajiga, and third, ja'ir al-muwafiq, حكام الجائر الشيعي مثل الألبوية أو مثل الجايتو. So they understood that they cannot go only with the distinction of جائر and عادل. Even جائرs can have different types. جائر الموافق, جائر المخالف, وجائر ال a kafir. So this is the second phase, the second period. Now we turn to the third period. Is everything all right so far? Any feedback?
Doctor, assalamu alaikum.
Yes, salam alaikum. Yes, please.
Doctor, you say about عصر الأئمة, عصر الغيبة, غيبة صغرى, غيبة الكبرى. After that, بويهيين, سنة سلاجقة. After that, مغول. After that, سلطان محمد خدابنده. I ask you that one question, very important. Why scientific Iranian and fuqaha move to two ways, from Sunnah and from Shia. One from Sunnah, for example, like Kulaini, Ibn Majah, Ibn Dawood, Tirmidhi, Bukhari, Gilani. From Shia, Kulaini, Tusi, Kafi. Two ways from Iranian. This scientific and fuqaha Iranian. Take two ways. Why? Please answer me.
Okay. Actually, my work has mainly been on political thought rather than the fiqh itself. So we know that there is a religious...
That question political. That question political thoughts.
Yes, this is mainly about the Islamic thought, Islamic kalam, Islamic fiqh, that it was, it has gone, as you mentioned, in Iran in two ways, or even in more than two ways, and different, for example, tawaif al-mukhtalifa. So I'm not very good in a position of discussing the reason for all types of thought. My focus is mainly on political thought. It is just a little part of Islamic culture. Islamic culture is more vast. It covers, as you mentioned, science. It covers kimya, covers, for example, nujum, to ulum al-lughawiyya, to ulum al-riyadhiyya, diverse types of ulum. So my expertise is mainly on political thought. It is difficult for me. I cannot actually explain the reason for other branches of knowledge. But we know that every society, when it gets complicated, when it confronted with different strands of thought, for example, when the Nehzat al-Tarjuma began in the second century Hijri and the third century Hijri, we know that many of Greek texts of philosophy and medicine had been translated into Arabic. Also, many texts from Iranian, Persian, and from Sanskrit, from India, were translated into Arabic. So there was a kind of, we know that there was a hub in Baghdad. There was this Darul Hikmah built by, established by Ma'mun. So different ideas came, and the Islamic empire was expanded from Andalus to Mawara al-Nahr, different types of people. So in this dialogue between them and the complication of Islamic civilization, it is expected to have different views. When there are different people, different backgrounds, different knowledge, of course, there is diversity of thought. And especially Baghdad is very important in this area. I remember that I read a text. It was said that I think it was from Firaqul Islami, Shahristani's Firaq. I forget the name. It was about the Islamic Firaq, and say that Baghdad was full of different ideas, different points of views, and everybody was preaching its own views. So to short my point is that actually in this diversity of cultures and diversity of people, it is expected to have different strands of thought. It is not very peculiar. It is not strange. It is usual, I think. Sorry if I couldn't answer this question. It was beyond my knowledge. If it's okay, I continue to the second stage, to the third stage. The third stage begins with the formation of the Safavid Empire. The formation of Safavid Empire is very important for the Shia. Why? Because it was for the first time in the history of the Shia when the Shia community has its own distinct society. Its own distinct society. Okay. Before that, of course, we have Shia communities all over the Muslim world. In, for example, in Qom, in Kashan, in Kufa, in even in some cities like Baghdad, we have different neighborhoods, Shia neighborhood, Sunni neighborhood. So they were living together. Shia were living actually inside Sunni communities. They didn't have a society completely of their own. They were mixed and mingled with the Sunni community. The formation of the Safavid Empire has brought this to the Shia community that they had now a community of their own. It was only their own community. Of course, we know that there were Sunni communities in Iran under Safavid, and still we have some Sunni communities here. It doesn't make different. But the point is that for the first time, the Shia religion was announced as the official religion of a society. So this made a drastic change. Before that, the Shia community was a minority community within the major community of the Sunnis. In that situation, it was first possible for the Shia to say that we don't have anything to do with politics. We withdraw from politics. There are many other people, the Sunnah, they want to do politics. They can do the politics. It doesn't matter. But when the Safavid Empire was formed, after that, they couldn't say that we don't have anything to do with politics. We leave politics. We withdraw from politics. It was not possible because the society was their own completely. So this made a different change. As we know, Safavid were a Turkish tribe. They conquered Iran step by step. They started from Ardabil, and they expanded their rule all over Iran. They proclaimed the Shia as the face of the state. Actually, the forces of Safavid were called Sufi Qizilbash, Red Hats. The driving force behind the Safavid Empire were the Qizilbash. Qizilbash were Turkish tribe with Sufism, Shia Sufism. They were the force that captured Iran and established the Safavid Empire. But the Safavid sultans, after a while, they wanted to get rid of these Sufi Qizilbash leaders. They wanted to rule for themselves. They didn't want any rival. They wanted to get rid of these Qizilbash commanders. And the second thing is that they needed a legal system. When you establish a state, of course, by force, it's okay at the beginning that you need to have force, troops to conquer, to conquest area. But after you established your government, you need rules, you need law, you need a legal system. For that purpose, they turned to Shi'at Fuqaha, to Shi'at scholars. In that time, most of the Shi'at scholars were based in Iraq as well as in Lebanon, in Lebanon. So they invited Fuqaha from Lebanon, from Iraq, to come to Iran and to help the Safavid to establish this legal system and to get rid of Sufi Qizilbash leaders. As we know here, there was a divide within the Shi'at clergy, within the Shi'at ulama, as to whether to cooperate with the Safavid or not. There were two groups. First group led by Qatifi, Allama Qatifi from Qatif. He was based in Najaf, of course. He said that, no, we couldn't cooperate with Safavid because they are Hukam al-Jair. There is no difference between Safavi or Usmani or Mughal or anybody. They are all Hakim al-Jair. So we continue our tradition of withdrawing from politics. We don't get involved in politics. We don't cooperate with Safavi, Safaviyya. The second group, they were led by Allama Karaki, Al-Karaki. Karaki said, no, it is, we should make a difference between Safaviyya and others. Safaviyya are Shia. They want to establish a Shia state. They want Shia rules, Shia laws. So we cooperate with them. Therefore, Karaki came to Iran, started cooperation with the Safaviyya. And this was the formation of the political discourse in the third phase, in the third period, which I call it a return to politics. The first was, as we remember, the first was the unity of politics and religion, the first phase. The second phase was completely different, political minimalism. And this third phase is a return to politics. If we go to my diagram, we will see that here is a U-turn. We come here, a return to politics. Shia political account has changed again toward politics. But I call it as hesitant return. Muraddad. It was not very firm. It was not very qati'. So what are the main elements of Shia political thought in this era? The first is the exclusive right of A'immat al-Ma'sumin to rule. Of course, this is always there. This is the distinctive identity of Shia. It is already there. And the second point is the dual authority of the king and the clergy. I mentioned this in the second stage as an emerging pattern. Then it was an emerging pattern. Here it is established point of political thought of the Shia, so that there is a divide. There is a dual authority, king and clergy. A kind of secularism, as I mentioned, but not a Western type of secularism. According to this divide, the clergy rule over the religious issues, fatwa, qaza, ahkam, amr bil ma'ruf, amr bil ma'ruf, nahi an al munkar. This is the area of the clergy, of ulama, fuqaha. They are called nawab al imam. They claim that they are nawab al imam. They are doing this qazawa, this fatwa, as naib al imam. Mislu naib al imam. For the king, the source of legitimacy was different. Sometimes they call it divine appointment. They say that kings are appointed by God, as Sultan Zillullah. This is under the Iranian, ancient Iranian account of thought. In ancient Iranian, pre-Islamic account of thought in Iran, the king sultan was appointed by God. So in the era of Safavid, sometime the king was called as appointed by Imam, by God. Sometime in some text, it is mentioned that they are Nawabul Imam as well. So there are some Nawabul Imam as Fuqaha and some Nawabul Fuqaha, Nawabul Imam Mislus Salatin. Sometimes they are the clergy's deputy. I don't know whether I am clear here or not. So there are different accounts of Sultan legitimacy. Sometimes he's appointed by God. Sometimes it is thought that it is Na'ibul Imam. Sometimes it is Na'ibul Imam. Na'ibul Fuqaha. Fuqaha, Mislul Karaki. We have a writing, a letter from Karaki, from Sultan Tahmasib al-Safavi to Karaki. In that, he mentions that I am your deputy. Sultan says to Karaki that I am your naib. You are naibul imam and I am your naib. I am ruling as your deputy, as your naib. So this is the main point in this period, in the third period. Again, we have some kind of emerging visions, evolving visions. In that era, we have the early stage of Wilayatul Faqih. Wilayatul Faqih was developed by people like Allama Karaki and Allama Naraqi. But not as we have it now under Imam Khomeini. It was a little bit different. It was the earliest stage. It was, as sometimes we say in Farsi, nutfa. It was not fully fledged. It was the beginning of some account of Wilayatul Faqih. So we go now to the fourth era, which I called it the modern era. The modern era is the period between the Iranian Constitutional Revolution of 1905 and the Islamic Revolution of 1979. The more important historical event in this period is first the confrontation with Western civilization. In this era, in this period, we have a confrontation between the West and Muslim countries. We know that many of Muslim territories were colonized since 17th century. For example, the Indian subcontinent was colonized. Many of African countries, including Muslim African countries, were colonized. The other thing was that actually in this era, we have the British domination of Iraq after the collapse of the Osmani Khilafah at the end of the First World War, when the Osmani Khilafah was collapsed. We know that there was this Sykes-Picot agreement in which the Middle East was divided between the French and the English. The English dominated Iraq. The other event, of course, here is that the Iraqi revolt of 1920, Thawrat al-Ashrin, which was very important. And as I mentioned, the other important event in this period is the Iranian Constitutional Revolution. The Iranian Constitutional Revolution was a revolution against dictatorship, against despotism. They wanted to have a modern state in Iran. So the revolution was began and was successful in two stages. I don't go into details. After the revolution, some modern political institution were formed. And the important point is that many Fuqaha who were based in Iraq, were based in Najaf, was supporting this revolution. And the revolution was successful because of the leadership of ulama and because of the its endorsement, ta'yid, by ulama fil Iraq and, of course, fil Iran. So the discourse, the political thought of Shia in this era, what was the difference? It was actually not much different from the other period, the previous period. The only difference is that they have, again, the dual authority of the ruler, the clergy, the divide between politics and religion. We know that in that era, the legitimacy of king was ascribed to God. It was kind regarded as appointed by God. But here in the modern era, with the constitutional revolution, Fuqaha mentioned that people have the right to rule. For example, Allama al-Na'imi has a short book called Tanbih al-Umma wa Tanzih al-Milla. It is in Farsi, but the name is in Arabic. It's a kind of mixture of Arabic and Farsi, actually. In that, he mentioned that the rule, the political rule, fil asr al-ghayba, is the rule of people. People have the right to rule over themselves. There is no concept of God, the concept of king anymore. There is no specific right for king. It is the right of people to rule over themselves. So it's a kind of modernizing Shia political thought. You will see that this is a new change in Shia political thought. It is modernized. It is recognizing the right of the people. I don't go to evolving vision because it is not much different from the previous.
Please. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
If
okay.
If you allow me, I have comment to save time, please.
Sure. Okay? Sure. Yeah.
Okay. I am Dr. Sajid.
Nice to meet you, Dr. Sajid.
Yes. Thank you very much. First, I would like to thank you for your useful and valuable scientific lecture. The lecture included a deep historical research since the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon you, upon him and his householders. If the focus is on Shia political thought against totalitarian regimes, the Shah regime in Iran and Saddam regime in Iraq. Through the analysis of the political thought of Imam Khomeini and the thought of religious scholars in Najaf, most notably Muhammad Baqir al-Sadr and his books, Our Philosophy and Our Economy, as well as Muhammad Sadiq al-Sadr, and what was mentioned in his political religious sermons. And Friday, prayers in 1998 and 1999. As you know, historical research benefits historical studies, the history department, the present professors and graduate students at in College of Law are more interested in the legal and political dimensions of Shia political talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm very thankful to your comments, and I thank all the participants. I have only one or two more slides in which actually I would like to refer to Muhammad Baqir Sadr and some Arab fuqaha. if it's okay, if we have time. Do we have time?
Of course, of course.
Okay, okay. Course. So we go to the fifth stage, which is contemporary era, beginning with the Islamic Revolution of Iran in 1979. We go through historical events very quickly. We have the, in Iran, we have the rule of Reza Shah, the father of Muhammad Reza Shah. He was exiled in 1949 during the Second World War from Iran, and his son was appointed as his successor. In that era, the Muhammad Reza Shah was very young, and he was not very much in control. His despotism was not formed yet in that time. So we have a surge in political activities in Iran. Various political parties were formed and started activities, including Marxist groups. For example, like Communist Party of Iran or Hizb ut-Tuda, they called in Iran. Alongside them, I think this was similar in Iraq. I think this in this era, Marxist and communist movement were formed in Iraq. And as far as I know, even many of the Shiite youth were attracted to Marxist movements. Alongside them, we have some groups under the name of religion in Iran, formed some religious political groups in Iran. For example, we have a group called socialist taste, means Muwahideen Socialiyya. If I pronounce the Arabic very good, it was Muwahideen Socialiyya. They were believed in God, but at the same time, they said that we believe in socialism. In that era, so there was a kind of expansion of political activities by religious groups. Ayatollah Kashani in Iran was elected as the Speaker of Parliament. So what I mean here is that there are many Islamic groups entering into politics more than before. It was not before that we didn't have that much involvement of Islamic group into politics. I think this happened in Iraq as well. At the same time, maybe a little bit later, that in reaction to communist movement, many Muslim movement, for example, in Iraq, as far as I know, Ad-Da'wah and other groups were formed. In this era, we have the emergence of Islamic intellectuals, like in Iran, Shariati, like Bazargan. They were not from the clergy, they were not from Fuqaha, but they have this kind of religious tendency, inclination. They tried to be active in politics. There are some as well, clergyman groups, like Kashani, as I mentioned, or like a person you may have heard his name, Nawab Safavi. Nawab Safavi formed a small group called Fada'iyan al-Islam. They were very radical. They were trying to form the Islamic government in then. So there were various groups. The common thread between them, the common point among these Muslim groups of diverse variety was their emphasis on the unity of religion and politics. They were trying to bring religion into politics. In that period, of course, Muhammad Reza Shah was interested in modernizing Iran. Iran was modernized intellectually and institutionally, but it was not democratized. There was modernization, but there was no democracy. There was not democratization. He was actually a suppressive government. He didn't allow any parties after a while. At the beginning, as I mentioned, at the beginning of his rule, because when he was young, he allowed, but when he his grip on power was become forceful, then he start dictatorship, and he banned political parties and political freedoms. This finally led to the Islamic Revolution of 1979, انقلاب الثورة الإسلامية في Iran. Of course, this is a long story, but I made it short. So we will go now to the political discourse of this era, what I called finally political activism. The main point here, the first is the exclusive right of infallible Imam, A'immat al-Ma'sumin. It is the similar in all phases, in all five phases. But what is different here is the political authority of faqih, wilayat al-faqih. In this era, we have a concept of wilayat al-faqih, which is articulated by Imam Khomeini. According to Imam Khomeini in his book called Hukumat al-Islamiyya aw Wilayat al-Faqih, according to him, it is mandatory for faqih to proactively provide for what is necessary for the formation of Islamic government. Look, the different, what is the difference between here and the second period? The second period, it was haram to try to establish a government. It was haram, it is forbidden. But here, the account is completely different. According to Wilayat al-Faqih, according to Imam Khomeini, it is wajib, it is mandatory for faqih to form an Islamic government. So this is the reason that I mentioned at the beginning that there is a U-turn in political thought of the Shia. According to the concept of Wilayat al-Faqih, it is the duty of every Muslim to preserve the Islamic government over other duties. As a Muslim, we have a lot of duties, ibadi, wa siyasi. Imam Khomeini mentioned that before our other duties, ibadat, what is important, what is awjab al-wajibat, is the duty of Muslim to preserve the government. So look, in the second period, if you remember, we have a kind of withdrawal from politics. Here, Imam Khomeini said that the political duty is have the priority over the religious duty. So we are going to a kind of, again, overlap between politics and religion. There are, of course, some discussion among fuqaha about the source and scope of Wilayat al-Faqih. What is the source of Wilayat al-Faqih? Some scholars, some fuqaha say that faqih is appointed by God. It is the deputy of Imam. So there is no need for people. There is no place for people's rule. Faqih is na'ibul Imam al-Ma'sum. This is one point. There is a second point. They say that no, people can and should elect Wali al-Faqih. It is the duty, it is the right of people to elect Wali al-Faqih. Again, about the scope of authority, the amount of authority, the first group say that the amount of authority of faqih is mutlaq, absolute. It covers everything. Faqih can rule over everything the same as Imam can rule over everything, Imam al-Ma'sum. So the authority of faqih is the same as authority of Imam al-Ma'sum. But there is a second view, for example, especially by Ayatollah Muntadhiri. He said that no, it is the authority of faqih is not unlimited. It is limited. It is based on the contract. On the contract between people and the government. And the contract is the constitution, the Dostur. So the authority is not absolute. So I don't go into that much. I just wanted to mention that the idea of Vilayat al-Faqih has its own different account. Some people have a democratic interpretation of Vilayat al-Faqih, like Ayatollah Muntazari. Some people have more authoritarian account of Vilayat al-Faqih, like Ayatollah Misbah. Imam Khomeini himself was somewhere between the two. So you will see sometime his democratic interpretation, Imam Khomeini's democratic interpretation of Vilayat al-Faqih, sometime he's authoritarian. Especially toward the end of his life, Imam Khomeini mainly become more democratic in his interpretation of Vilayat al-Faqih. But I pass this one. I go to the evolving visions. So again, here there is a second layer. There are other accounts of politics among the Shia. I mentioned several of them. I'm sure there are more, but I mentioned several of them. One is by Ayatollah Muhammad Baqir al-Sadr. He has several accounts of politics, Shia politics. He changed his view a little bit, but mainly he talks about a elected government. For him, Faqih has only a kind of supervision right. So he doesn't have execution right. He has kind of nevara, supervision. He just supervises the government. He doesn't rule himself. And the government is more elected.
One minute, Doctor, please. 1 minute, please.
Okay. In 1 minute. And there are then
subject Vilayat al-Faqih modern before three centuries. Before three centuries.
Yes. I agree with you. I agree with you that the you know the concept of Vilayat al-Faqih
before three centuries.
In a minute. The concept of Vilayat al-Faqih itself is not recent, but Vilayat al-Siyasiyah is recent. So there has always been the authority of Faqih, but this authority was not political. This authority was mainly in religious era, in fil qazawa, fil fatwa. But during the time, and especially with Imam Khomeini, he expanded this authority, this wilaya, to siyasa. So the concept of wilaya itself is not new. The concept of wilayat al-siyasiyat al-faqih is more new. And of course, when people like Imam Khomeini talks about wilayat al-siyasiyat al-faqih, they refer to the text. They believe that Islam always has this authority for faqih, political authority for faqih. But we know that there are different point of view. For example, Ayatollah Sistani and Ayatollah Khoi, contemporary fuqaha, they say that many contemporary fuqaha, they say that faqih doesn't have wilayat al-siyasiyah, political authority. The wilayat al-faqih is wilayat fil umur al-hisbiyah. So this is the point. You are right. Just I finish this slide. Then there are other Muslim Shi'at like Muhammad Mehdi Shamsuddin and Muhammad Jawad Mughniya. They talk about elected government, democratic government. They don't consider any role for Faqih, any prerogative for Faqih. So Faqih for them doesn't play any role, not even a supervision role, supervising role. They go for a completely democratic account of government in Shi'at view. There is one other person called Mehdi Ha'ari Yazdi, he's Iranian. He talks about, again, elected government. There are many of them. I'll just bring here some examples. They he talked about government as a wakala. Government look like a wakala. As we give somebody our wakala to defend us in the court, we can elect some people as our wakil in politics for a short period of time to rule over us. And after that, we can get back the wakala and give it to somebody else. So for Mehdi, Hariri and Yazdi as well, government is a kind of elected government, and there is no special role for the faqih, for the clergy. There are some other people as well, Abdul Karim Surush and many other Shi'at scholars here and there, and they talk about secularism in Islam, they in Shi'at thought. So they think that the Shi'at account of politics should be completely secular. What I was trying to mention in discuss in this talk was that we don't have a one account of Shia political thought. There has been several accounts. Shia political thought has changed, developed during the time, and the conclusion is that Shia political thought has transformed from a passive to an active approach in the course of history. So at the beginning, after the era of Imam, with the Asr al-Ghaiba, there was a passive approach to politics, but it changed into an active approach now. Shia political thought has been as much a product of text, product of Nas, Nusus, as it has been a response to social and political realities. So my point is that Shia political thought is not just product of Nusus. It is actually, it has been in dialogue with realities out there, with political realities, social realities. For example, when Safaviyat come, they changed. When Ghaiba started, they changed. When they in the modern era, they changed again. So it was responsive to social reality. It was not a kind of political thought irresponsive or not in dialogue with reality. No, it was in dialogue with reality. The exclusive right of imams to rule is the common theme in all periods. In all periods, there was this حق الأئمة المعصومين في الحكومة. But the implication of this theme has been interpreted differently in different eras. So the account of the rule of A'immat al-Ma'asumin was interpreted differently in different era. The roots of the dominant political discourse in each era can be found in the previous era. But this is important as well, that the dominant political discourse in each period has its roots in the previous era. So it was a kind of reaction to events that happened before. And the final point that is that those clergies, those fuqaha that followed a rationalist approach rather than text-based, they have been more prone to welcoming politics back to Shi'at social life and theorizing. But here I mean that ulama al-usuliyin, more than akhbariyin, tried to accept, to welcome back politics, to theorize politics. So usuliyin were more responsive to politics, try to develop, to articulate responses for the Shi'at community, for their account of politics. This was my last slide. I thank you all for listening to my talk. I'm sure that most of you had more knowledge of it. I will be very pleased to have your point of view here or even afterward. We can discuss through email or through other instruments, social instruments, whatever. Thank you again very much for listening to my paper. I'm ready to listen to your feedback and reaction or questions.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Musel.
All Iraq come on for school Khoi, مدرسة الأصولية, not school for ولاية الفقيه. Thank you for your opinion and your discuss your thought from history, from Shia. Thank you, very thank you, all pupils. Thank for us.
Thank you very much. Yes, actually, as my main point here is that was that actually we don't have one account, as you mentioned, that is, for example, even in Iran, of course, the dominant account, the official account, is Velayat al-Faqih. But even in Iran, we know that among fuqaha fil Iran, there are different point of view. They don't have the same view. Some of them, they follow, for example, Sistani or Khoi's account of view even in Iran. And we know that, for example, Shia in Lebanon may have their own different point of view. Of course, it is important for us as Shia to accept diversity, to accept that each society have the right to have its own account of political thought. It is not the case. My point was that actually it is not one account that we can impose on each other. No, it is not like that. We can have our own diversity of point of view. And this is the good for Shia. What is important about the Shia political thought is that it was not constant. It was not stopped in the time. It turned, it changed, it developed, and it should develop again.
But when, Doctor, sorry, but when Iraq need fatwa, Sistani can fatwa al-jihad al-kifai. That is like wilayat al-faqih. That is like wilayat al-faqih.
I appreciate the role played by Ayatollah Sistani. I think it was very wise. It is very wise and my appreciation.
Thank you.
I met Ayatollah Sistani myself about 6-7 years ago. We had a short talk with each other, and I enjoyed his point of view. It's very nice.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
Okay, I'm not sure whether there are more questions or not. Unfortunately, I forget to send my email send my email address to you. But I'm not sure whether it's possible to have it here, to write it somewhere here. But it would be very nice. It would be very nice if I have. If we can contact with each other sometime later. This is my email address.
Salam alaikum.
Salam alaikum. This is my email address here. I will put it on to so that I appreciate if we can have if we are in contact with each other sometime later. Yes, please, go ahead.
Salaamu alaikum.
Salaamu alaikum.
Excuse me, I can speak Russia language and Iran language because I forget English language. I can question, I can to ask you about your research in Iranian language, okay?
Yeah, all right, sure.
سلام خیلی ممنونم ما خیلی واقعا استفاده کردم در موردی بحثتون ولی یه نکته دارم شما گفتی بی این خیلی مختلف باشه منابع اصولی اسلامی در مورد شیعت خیلی مختلف باشه مثلا شما توضیح دادید در مورد ولایت فقیه در جمهوری اسلامی ایرانی ولی در عراق واقعا اینجوری نیستش به این علت ما نمیتونیم این بحث این منظورتون واقعا موجود در عراق نیستش این نکته اول نکته دوم ما باید جستجو کنیم در مورد مثلا چجوری بعضی نظامی حدیث باشه مشترک به نظامی اسلامی باشه مثلا در مورد حقوق بشر مثلا چجوری در مورد احکام اسلام موجود باشه یا موجود نباشد همه چیز خیلی با ارزشه به این علت مثلا در غرب هیچ تصور نکردند هیچ تصور نمی کنند در مورد احکام اسلام بیرامون حقوق بشر باشند بین علت باید ما واقعا ارزو دارم به این نکته همه چیز توضیح می دهید اگر زحمت نمی کشه نکته سوم می خواهم بپرسم در مورد همه چیز نظامی دیموکراتیه در جمهوری اسلامی چجوری معمول باشند در موردی مثلا اختیار انتخابی مثلا انتخابی همه انتخاباتی در ایران چجوری می شود در مورد احکام اسلام همه چیزی در مورد حقوق بشر به این علت باید همه توضیح می خواهیم در این مسئله واقعا خیلی متشکرم بحثتون خیلی با ارزش ما خیلی استفاده کردیم ممنون دستت در نکن خیلی ممنون دکتر
شکرا دکتر هاشم شكراً. Unfortunately أنا أحكي بالعربي شوية. Therefore I have to say it in English. Very sorry. My apologies. About the first point that you mentioned, of course there is a difference between Iraq and Iran and other Shiite communities, for example, Shiite in Lebanon, they have a majority, but it's a relative majority in, for example, Saudi Arabia, in Qatif, they are a minority. Shiite communities in a different part of the world, they have different situations, so there is no one formula for all of them. No, it's not like that. I accept your point of view that every society, even every Shiite society, has to go its own way to see which kind of theories is appropriate for his situation. The good thing about Shiite political thought, that, as I mentioned, it's not just one. There are many. So Shiite Muslims, Shiite communities have many choices to see which kind of account is good for them, Wilayat al-Faqih or not. How to deal with other societies? For example, Shamsuddin, he was talking about Lebanon. He knew that Lebanon is not Iran. It has its own history, its own social situation. So it should be a different point of view. I accept that. We should, I think what is important is that we should recognize within the Shiite communities, not only within Shiite, even within Islamic society as a whole, even as a world altogether, we should accept our differences. I am Iranian Shia, actually a little bit of Arab root, and you are completely Iraqi Shia. We have similarities, we have differences. We as a Shia have similarities together, but we have differences with Sunnis. We should accept our differences. We should recognize Sunnis as a different. Why not? They have their own right. We should recognize their rights. Not only Sunnis, but even Christians, non-Muslim, we should recognize them. Being a Muslim, being a Shia does not mean that we have a right to deprive other from their own right, from other religion from their own right. No, I don't think it's that like that. We should recognize each other. Your second and third point is important as well. We as a Muslim, as a Shia Muslim, should know that we live in modern era. There are حقوق الإنسان, حقوق البشر, minority rights, democracy, freedom. We should incorporate them into Islam, into Shia thought. Shia thought cannot be something belong to 100 years of ago. No, it should thrive now. It should respond to new and modern way of life. Otherwise, this community will no longer can exist. We should accept democracy. We should accept election to the extent possible. I think this is one of our duty as a scholar, Shia scholar, to make Shia doctrine compatible with modern concepts.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Hashem. Okay, Dr. Ambar, are you there still? I'm not sure whether Dr. Ambar is there or not, but...
Sorry, Dr. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Is that okay if we end now? If there is any question, or we should finish the meeting?
Yes, thank you, Doctor, for this presentation. It was a good presentation and helpful. Thank you so much. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much. It was very nice for me to talk to you. As I mentioned, I'm sure that you have more, many of you have more knowledge than me, even in this topic. I hope that sometime we can meet each other in person and to talk. Even if not in person, we can still talk through this social media and exchange our view and have a better understanding of each other. My pleasure and my thanks to all of you and to the University of Basra.
Thank you, dear doctors. Thank you.
Thank
so
you,
much.
Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Ambar. Thank you, Dr. It's dull. Shukran.
Shukran, أعزائي وطلابني. شكراً لحضوركم واستماعكم. العفو بس التذكير. أكو لينك بال نشرته على مود التسجيل حضور اللي يحب يسجل حضور. شكراً للجميع.
شكراً دكتور. للجميع. أسلم عليك في أمان الله.
في أمان الله.
ممكن تعيد نشرة دكتور العفو والرابط؟
Pardon؟
لا العفو الدكتور عنبر يمكن مو يعني على مود رابط الحضور ممكن يعيد نشرة؟
إيه موجود بال شو اسمه بالتعليقات.
ما ظهر عندي والله.
هسه راح أرسل مرة ثانية إن شاء الله.
ممنونة شكراً جزيلاً شكراً جزيلاً الدكتور سيد. ممنونين
شكرا سلم عليك في امان الله
ست ها وضح ليش هسه نشرته من جديد ست؟
نعم دكتور، شكرا جزيلا، ممنونة.
شكرا شكرا، بالتوفيق، حياك الله ست.